So today I'm really excited. We're kicking off kind of a new series. This is something that was requested by a bunch of subscribers, and I'm excited to do it. I've been doing a lot of research, and well, we woke up this morning and to a blizzard, and it's snowing outside. I've been watching it. We're accumulating about an inch an hour. I mean, it is coming down. Visibility is maybe 50 feet. It's just unbelievable, unprecedented. So here's what we're doing. So what I've been asked by you guys is that, can you help us to put together a bare bones, super, super affordable, but usable, quality, serviceable, we'll call it, woodworking toolkit? These are hand tools. These are not power tools. We talked about lots of different budgets. We talked about, you know, what should we limit it at? Maybe $250. Some people said $500. I'm not going to limit it to a budget, but I am going to tell you, we're going to try to do it cheap. So we're going to spend money where we need to spend money, but let's make this available for everyone, from the 15-year-old that's got a job part-time and going to school to the senior citizen on a fixed income. Let's put together a basic kit that you can build something with. And I think the first project that we should build would be a tool grip. So here's what I'm thinking. So as the weather, you know, we'll work on this as the weather drives us into the shop, but what I'd like to do is to put together this basic kit, and then we'll use this kit to build a very simple tool storage box, like a grip, like a mini version of what I built for my timber framing tools. And at the end of this, what I'll do is, once I assemble this whole kit, and we'll go over everything, and if something doesn't work, you know, we'll just keep trying until we find something that does, and then one of you guys is going to win the kit, including the toolbox that I built. So how you are going to be eligible for that is, you got to comment on every video, and I'll be able to search that and just be engaged. If you comment on the video, then you'll be in the running towards the end. So how long will it take? You know, I don't know, maybe a couple weeks, maybe a couple months, but there's not a lot of tools. It's not going to be a great expense. But today, so we'll get to it. Today we're going to start with, I did my research, and we're going to start with the number 4 bench plane, the hand plane. Now, my favorite one, and the one that I've really enjoyed using, is, of course, Stanley's top of the line. It's their Stanley Sweetheart, their number 4 bench plane, you know, coming in to just under $150. A lot of money for someone that isn't, you know, going to be really serious about woodworking. So what we're going to be checking out today and trying out, and this is what I'm proposing for the first purchase of our common man's, we'll call it the common man's toolkit, is another Stanley plane, but it's their lowest end plane. And I had never seen it before. It just came in the mail, and it's the Stanley SB4. And believe it or not, this can be had on Amazon between $15 and $20. That includes shipping. Very, very cheap, very affordable. I didn't know what to expect when I got it. It's got, some people really liked it. You know, it's got kind of a mixed reviews. One thing that everyone said was it needs a lot of work, a lot of tuning up before it can be used, which is common with every plane. Of course, you know, unless you're maybe paying huge, huge money for an American-made custom or small-built plane, but even these, you know, need a fair amount of work. So this is it. So let's bring in the camera and let's show the differences, because it has major differences between these two. And then we'll tune it all up. We'll see how bad, how uneven everything is. We'll take a look at the iron, and then we'll try it out and see, is this a viable option? Is this a usable, let's say a serviceable tool that we can start our kit with for under $20? So let's compare these two planes. What do we have? $150. We've got basically $20. So right off the bat, we can see that of course the Sweetheart is heavier, more precise castings, certainly more options. Starting with the front, so we've got a cherry handle here, right there. That's, of course, you know, very traditional, nice. But what we have here on these are plastic. That surprised me. I thought they were going to be painted wood, but it is plastic. Plastic back, plastic front. Pretty comfortable, a little bit smaller than the Sweetheart, but I think totally serviceable. There's a ridge on them where it's not going to be super comfortable on your hand, but that could be taken off, knocked off with a file. So same goes here. I just noticed it. I haven't even used it yet, but right there, that's pretty sharp there, but that's not a big deal. The other major difference, of course, you know, is we have an adjustable, forgive me, I don't know the terminology, adjustable front here, which gives us, you know, we can move this and out, change the opening of the throat there, and, you know, give it some, you know, if we're having trouble with tear out different types of wood. You know, most of us, I can't say that I've ever really fooled with that too much. I can't really say that I understand it, to be honest with you. I've never had it, never used it, so don't really know how important that is. The big differences are going to be coming into how, of course, the blade and the lack of a chip breaker on here. So if we take off our cap here on the Sweetheart, and we take off this little cap right here, we can see, same principle. You know, we've got the screw tensioner there, right there, but pretty big difference there, right? You can see the cast aluminum. That's a nice piece there. Very light, the solid brass screw versus just a kind of a cheap cast pop metal. But is it going to do the job? No. Maybe it is. We're going to see. Here's a huge difference. Of course, we've got the ability to adjust in and out, our blade up and down, as well as, you know, moving it. We can adjust it from side to side. And the huge difference with this one is you're not, if you do need to change the depth of the blade, you're going to be screwing these out. Now, if you want to raise it up, you're going to have to reset the angle. You know, so it's a little bit not quite as user friendly. Here's the iron. Looking at the iron, it's covered with varnish. You can see it has a very crude machine ground edge with nicks and burrs and chips. Not at all suitable to use. Not a problem though. We're gonna address that, take a look at it. No removable frog, just everything cast in. Pretty clever little design though. I mean, it's kind of interesting. Lack of chip breaker and a very thin blade too. What's that going to cause? You know, if we're going to be using it maybe on some really tough knots or hardwood, we could expect probably a little chattering on it, not going to be as stable. That's really a bad edge on there. I can feel it just from my fingers there. Versus the Sweetheart, of course, where we have, look how thick that blade is. That's a heavy, nice heavy blade. This sure seems like a nice plane for the money. I really have enjoyed it. But look how thin that is right there. Pretty thin, pretty thin. But you know, there's no such thing as a free lunch. You know, yeah. By and by, you know, you kind of get what you pay for. So there's the. Of course, we got the chip breaker on there. A little bit different. It's not really a chip breaker. What is that? You know, it's. I didn't really have this had this off before. That's interesting. It's like there's two blades on there. Now I didn't remember how I put it back. Did it go this way? Solid brass screws. We've got. Do we have an adjustable frog on that? Looks like that's not. Looks like it's all cast into one piece. I don't know what this is. I should have probably did my homework there before I took this apart. But we're not. It's not about this plane. It's about this one here. But just so you could kind of see some of the differences. The handle's not as big. But casting is certainly not as thick, not as heavy, not as robust. But no, I'm surprised. I mean, it looks better than I thought it would be. All right, gentlemen, here's where we start with any plane you get. Doesn't matter if it's a $300 plane or a $15 plane, we're going to do the same thing, and it's not hard to do. It just takes a little elbow grease. What I've used, this belonged to my Nana. This was a, you know how our older people were, you know, with the plastic on the couch and the glass on all the end tables. You don't want to keep things nice. She was very fancy. She had put glitter on everything. She was a fancy lady. But it's just, you can get these at, you can go to thrift store or whatever. You can find these. They're everywhere. They're super cheap. And glass is flat. Glass is very, you know, interesting thing about glass that I learned this years ago from an old guy that was a glazier. That's a guy that does glass for a window. He said that they had found that old lead glass windows, you know, the old paned windows, that they were still fluid. And I didn't know what he was talking about. He said, yeah, he goes, so the glass was put in, let's say the glass was put in and it's pained, you know, and it sat there for 100 years. And over the time, gravity and everything pulled that glass down and it was fatter at the bottom. You could tell because sometimes they had a hard time getting it out, you know, between the styles and all of that. He said, yeah, absolutely. He goes, everyone, it's true. The glass is still, even though it seems like it's hard, it's in its fluid state, it turns in that teardrop shape. I never could get over. I thought that was the most interesting thing. So something flat, good piece of glass, go to a glass shop. They'll have scraps for you. You can get a nice thick piece of tempered, you know, nicer than this. This is what I have and it works just fine. You want wet, dry sandpaper. Wet, dry sandpaper is used by the auto body guys. It used to be. I don't know, do you guys do repairs anymore? Or is it just, you just replace parts now? It used to be, you know, Bondo and sanding and all of that. but it's wet dry paper, so it works good with water. So sandpaper really, you know, it builds up quickly. It fouls itself. But if you can use wet dry paper, which will hold up under moisture, it carries away all of that stuff. So get yourself a sheet. 320 seems a good place to start. Get yourself a water bottle with, doesn't matter, right? This has Simple Green in it, but you don't need that. And what this will do is this will make it stick, you know, kind of make some surface tension right there. You know, it takes a little while. You gotta keep spraying it. Get it all nice and wet like this. Right there. Man, it's nice having a nice clean paper. Brand new piece of sandpaper. All right, so make sure you have it tensioned, you know, all your stuff in there. You want it to be that way. And we'll go back and forth on here. And just a few times, and it's going to, this is the acid test. It's gonna tell us how good, how bad the machining is on any particular plane. Chisel, any of that sort of thing. I have a fleeting suspicion that this one's going to be very bad, but who knows? Made in Mexico, I saw in the packaging. All right, you ready to see the unveiling? Let's take a look. It's gonna tell us how much work we've got. I have to say, these plastic handles, those ridges on them, those gotta come off. They're uncomfortable. Okay, so what do we have here? We have, just what I suspected. Can you see this? So we've got wear right there. We can see the smooth portions. This machining is very rough on this. You see all the grains in it? But you can see where we're smooth. We're smooth here and here. At least it's consistent across there. I'm showing you where we're high. We're high along the sides, we're high there, and we haven't even touched anywhere in the middle. So what that means is we've got a fair amount of work to do on that. You see the polish there? I can get the light right. But it's doable. So, you know, when you come home from work and you go out to the shop and you get your wet dry sandpaper and you put your favorite program on or whatever, this is what you're gonna do. You're gonna do this for a long time. Okay, so this is about an hour with 320 grit. Let's see what we have here. Well, we have made some progress there. We can see that we have, our high spots are coming down. Let's get the light right. Can you see that? We're polishing here. We're touching here, touching in the middle now, all the way down the sides. So it is pretty consistent. We're low here, touching there and there. So it is coming down. Am I gonna do any more than that? Not in your life. I have better things to do, but it could be done. How long would it take to bring this particular one down? I don't know. 4 hours? 5 hours, I'm guessing? And a dozen sheets of abrasive? Could be done, but that's as far as I'm gonna go. Now, let's turn our attention to the iron. Turn our attention to the iron and see how bad that's going to be. So for the iron, we're gonna go over here to the diamond stones here. Now this is, as we've talked about in the past, this is an investment. You know, you're gonna have, what are you gonna have? You know, a couple hundred, $225 or so into these three stones. It's not necessary. You can do the same thing with the sandpaper. I did for a long time, but this is, you know, if you wanna get serious about it, it's pretty nice. Okay, so the first thing we're gonna do, we wanna see how flat is this? How flat is this iron? And this is the same thing we're gonna do with our chisel. So we're gonna go on the, what is that? 320 grit, I think. I think that's a 320 grit stone. And this is the wonderful Paul Sellers mounting bracket. And I got this idea from him. This is what he had, and it's just wonderful. I use it once a week or so. I go from coarse to medium to super fine. And it's always ready. Chalk it up in the vise. You can sharpen anything on it. It's just a great thing. Great thing. Okay, so let's do this a little longer and we'll see. Man, this is gonna take a while. Get my hanky here. A man is not dressed without his handkerchief. Okay, that's not too bad. You can see that right there. You see the high spots there? Okay, so we're high here and here, but it's moving along pretty good there. I think just a little bit more. Maybe 10 minutes or so, and we'll have it. So I'm about 10 minutes into the process there, switched over to the medium, and we'll just polish a little bit up there on the fine. And it wasn't too bad. I'd say for this one, whatever that means, I don't know what your sample is gonna be, would probably be about 10 to 15 minutes of work. And you're gonna get the same rate on the sandpaper right there, as the wet and dry sandpaper works good too there. Okay, so as we can see, we are indeed flat now, less that little corner right there. You still see the machine marks in it right there, and maybe a tiny bit right there. That's all I'm gonna go. Maybe another 5-10 minutes, you could get that all out of there, but you'll eventually get it, right? So just feeling this, I mean, there's a tremendous wire burr on there. This is horrible right there. The angle looks pretty decent, but that shouldn't be too bad. So we'll go back over here to the course. If you're using the sandpaper, just get the 320, and of course, you know, find this angle. And a little practice, you can do this. Very rough edge, you can feel it. The medium, it looks good, starting to get very sharp. Now we'll just go finish over here on the super fine. I know all you Japanese waterstone guys are always very keen on telling me that's not super fine, I know. I like to say super fine. Rolls off the tongue, doesn't it? All right, let's a little bit more. I can feel it smoothing up. Nice polish going on there. This is an essential skill every man should have. You should be able to sharpen every tool in your shop. Have the means and the skill, the ability to do it. Okay, let's take a look at that. So that's getting that's a nice polish on there, isn't it? You can feel the wire. So that wire is just, you know, that as you're sharpening, it's just that little bit of a steel that gets shaved off that kind of hangs out there. You can take and lay it flat and give it a pull like that. And that's feeling sharp. Still got the wire. You can get that wire off there by, you know, running it a piece of hardwood like that. I don't know if you can see it there, but I can see it when I did that. That little wire came off right there. Let's give it just a couple more light ones, and then we'll take it over to the leather. The leather is the important way to finish it. Light, the weight of your hands. It's always very interesting to me how some things just can't be improved upon. And to really put the finishing touches on any sort of an edge, there's nothing better than leather with a compound on it, you know, jeweler's rouge. And you just go pressing hard as you can. Angle doesn't matter so much. Get close, but don't worry about it. And we'll go across there pressing hard. 50. That's my number. So let's see what this thing will do here. All right, so we're going to put it back together. Pretty simple, this one. So look, I forgot. Bevel up, bevel down. The instructions said bevel down. So it did come with honing instructions and all of that. We'll put that on there. And this is a unique way of setting up a plane. I don't see anything wrong with it, you know, because we have two adjustments on a plane, you know, how deep the blade goes into the wood, and that's going to depend on many factors, depending on, you know, how much you want to cut and the type of wood, and of course, if we're cutting crooked or not. So I'll show you how to set these up. It's going to be the same on every plane. Got that screw set, right? That's as far as that's going to be down there. So we'll have a little bit of, I'm going to leave this not super tight so we can still play with these guys a little bit. So what I've got for you here is we've got a nice piece of 3/4 inch hemlock. Can you see that? Do I need to move? camera. Looks like we've got a little better angle there. Okay, so 3/4 is a good thickness. This is a soft wood, and what we're looking for is how to adjust that iron left and right. Is we're gonna cut both. Look, try to cut both sides. So I'm not even touching yet. So I'm gonna go down one turn there, go down one turn here. Still not touching. We'll just keep. There we go. Back it off a little bit. We're just making contact there. Come over to this side. Now really making contact, too much contact. So we'll bring that back until we're... Now each time you move one side, of course, you know it's going to change the other. Just getting a shaving there. No shaving here. So we'll keep going down. Oops, going the wrong way. Goodness. Oh, that's a thick shaving there. We don't want one that thick. But let's see. Are we getting the same thick shaving on the other side? Yeah. Okay, so we're pretty consistent there. So let's back it up. We don't want to... That's a lot of wood to cut off there. So we'll back these off just a little bit. I'm going to tighten that down a bit. I want just a... We want a thin shaving, not touching there, so we're going to go back down. A little bit goes a long ways in these things. Okay, that's pretty thick. I can feel I'm against the grain. We don't want that. We want to go with the grain. Feels better. Feels better. Okay, still working here, still. So what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to get a, first off, I need the wood to be flat. Okay, that's cutting nice. Now what I want to do here is I'm going to go off to the one side. I'm going to take that shaving, I'm going to sit it right here on the left side, right? I'm going to go over to the extreme other side, the right side. I'm going to take that shaving. I'm going to compare these two. I can feel the one on the left is thicker, twice as thick. And so what that tells me is I need to come up just a little bit because it's cutting too deep on one side. So I've got a thin shaving there. Okay, I'm just going too far. Super thin shaving there. Still a thick shaving there. Let me go down just a tiny bit. Boy, it's the adjustment is pretty coarse on this. I can see that. You have to, it just takes such a little bit. Good shaving. Okay, I like that. That feels right to me there. So let's try it one more time. Here's our left shaving. Now we're going to do our right shaving. And those, I can feel them. I can feel them that they are. And you can look through them, you know, if you can see how they, can you see more light through one or the other? Those are almost exactly the same. Okay, so I'll tighten down the cap there. And let's see how it works. Is this a serviceable tool? Could we get by with this plane? I'm just going to talk about my experience here, what it's like. So the plane, the way it's laid out is comfortable to me. The handle is comfortable, all apart from it hurts my hand, these ridges, these casting marks. Those need to be sanded off. But it is cutting very nice. Look at these nice shavings here. Aren't those nice? Nice and consistent. Super thin. Super thin. But so the question is this a serviceable tool? Put a chamfer on there. Let's see. A nice chamfer on there. Maybe this side. You know, it works really good. It's very sharp.
It is comfortable to use. It has a decent weight. I don't feel too cramped up on it. I don't have great expectations for it because it's under $20. But could we use this? Is this going to be something that we can use in building our toolbox? I think it is.
All right, so some final thoughts. And the question that we're going to have to answer is this going to make it into our common man's toolbox as a plane? I'll talk about the things I like about it. The things I like about it, of course, right off the top of it, is going to be the price. Between $15 and $20 shipped, you can't beat it. You just can't beat the price. I like the layout of it. I like the size of the handles. I don't mind the adjustment as an extra step. You know, if you need to go deeper or you need to go shallower, you know, there may be a need to readjust the angle. So, it's a little bit more time consuming, but it is relatively easy to use. Is it good? Is it what I consider to be a good plane? I'm not going to go so far as to say that it's a good plane, but I would say that it is a serviceable plane. It is good enough to make it into our kit. And with that, I'm going to say for probably use on light duty with soft woods, which is what you're going to be using anyway. Soft woods like pines or firs or hemlocks, those are usually more affordable, especially the pine. The pine is the best wood to start with because it's very soft and very forgiving, very, very cheap. You can get it at any big box store anywhere. And it's a nice wood. It makes a nice finished product. I mean, who doesn't like knotty pine? It's just, it's a very nice, and it's a nice wood to work with. And as you saw with the hemlock, which is a little bit harder than pine, not much, it worked great. Nice even strips and even pretty thick stuff there. I could definitely use it with that. Hardwood, not so much. But is the beginning woodworker going to go out and spend a lot of money on and work with the hardwoods, which are harder? I don't know. Maybe to consider. Did not work as well with the hardwood as it did with the softwood. And I think it's probably has a lot to do with the thickness of the iron. Will it hold an edge? You know, time will tell. I ran it pretty hard through that maple off camera quite a bit. And just looking at it, I don't see any nicks. I don't see any damage. And it seems to be plenty hard. So those are the things that I do like about it. I like the look of it. I mean, it's not a toy. It's not a joke. The plastic handles don't bother me. They didn't come loose. And that's pretty telling. You can adjust them and tighten them up. You know, it's like the Glock of planes. Things I don't like about it, of course, we're talking about the handles. You know, it's got the plastic ridges on it. Sandpaper will sort that out. Not a problem. Don't mind the plastic whatsoever. I don't like the fact that it's going to take so much work to flatten out the sole of it. The iron, I don't have a problem with it. I didn't have any problem getting that sharpened up. That was pretty simple. But this is going to take some work. So know that going into it. It's a little bit light. It's a little bit, does it give me the warm and fuzzy to operate it, to own it, to have it in the toolbox? It does not. But it also doesn't make me cringe, or I wouldn't feel ashamed. You know, too bad this doesn't happen very often, you know, but if we had, you know, communities where, you know, my neighbor says, hey, come on over and we're going to work on this. You know, you help me and I'll help you. And I brought my grip of tools on there. And if I had this in the toolbox, I wouldn't feel like I need to bury it or hide it. I don't think it's, I think it's a real tool. I think it's a great value. And it's going to make it into the list. So, yeah, that's what it is. You know, that's what it is. It's a great starter plane. It's a good place to start. And I, apart from its few shortcomings and not trying to operate it outside of what it is intended for, then I think it's fine. So here's what you need to do. Show support to the channel by commenting. If you comment and tell me there's two things I want to know, well, here's what I want you to comment about. What's going to be the next tool to test? What I'm thinking is chisels. You know, so does a guy need to go out and spend $125, $50 for a set of Stanley Sweetheart chisels, or can we get something that's affordable? Let's look at the $10, $15 range, you know, and how many chisels do we need? Well, we need three, really. We need maybe four, maybe a quarter, half, three quarter, and one, or maybe half. I could probably get away with half, three quarter, and one would probably do it. Maybe we'll just go with the three chisel set. If you want to see chisels, should we go and pick out the saw for the kit? What should we do? What do you want to see? Because we're going to need, you know, something to measure with. We're going to need a good tri square. We're going to need a combination square. We need a plane, a saw, you know, good hammer. But I don't think it's going to be, I don't think it's going to be any problem to keep this whole project, everything under right around the $200 range. Seems to me. I think we'll spend a little bit. Want to spend a little bit more on a saw, but not a lot. So. Please comment and click a thumbs up, and that's going to make you eligible. Maybe you can receive the kit. I'll put a link to this in the, we'll start a new category in WranglerMart.com. That's my Amazon affiliate store where you can get these. And they're right now, they're on special, I think $20 shipped if you want to start building your kit. If not, you can wait. Maybe you'll be one of the few, or one of the one who may win the kit. So that's it. The Stanley SB4. It's gonna make it. It'll make it. The very first choice for our common man's toolkit. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you guys on the next video.